Welcome to Seneca Creek Community Church. My name is Nikki. I'm the worship arts pastor here, and I want to give you a little bit of an insight of what it looks like when you come into 13 First Field. First and foremost, you'll probably walk in and you'll see one of our amazing host team, and they'll welcome you into the building. Hi, Abram. And if you have kids, you're going to bring them into these doors, and you're going to take them on into Powerhouse, where Brooke is going to let them know that they're loved and cared for. So we're going to say hi to her today. She's got a gang of volunteers helping her out today. So that's awesome. We'd love to see it, Brooke. We are just asking people, what is it that they love about Seneca Creek?
I love how much fun the kids' place is.
Awesome. We love for people to have fun, to come together, to worship the Lord with joy and gladness. Amen. So if this is your first or second time joining us on our stream, we want to encourage you to click the link in the chat and let us know that you're here. Let us know that you're watching for us to be able to know you and to care for you. And yeah, for you to get to know us. And so I'm going to kick it off to the worship team now. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. How's everybody doing? Wonderful. I can't hear anything. Is it just me? Okay. Well, I'm glad you're here. If this is your first or second time in the building today, I want to encourage you to scan the QR codes that are on the back of the chairs. It's an opportunity for you to get to know us and for us to get to know you. And if you're watching us online, there's a link in the chat for you to click to let us know you're watching as well. Again, just to get to know us and to get to know you. And ultimately, we're just so glad you're here with us. So we pray that you know that you are loved and welcomed before you even set in the room. So we're glad you're here. My prayer for you this morning, as it is every Sunday morning, no matter who is leading worship, my prayer is that you have come with great expectancy to meet with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the one who speaks all things into existence, cares for you. So whatever it is that you've come to this place with, whatever burdens, cares, or anxieties, whatever hopes and dreams, the Lord is faithful to meet you today. So if this is your first or second time, Seneca Creek is a multicultural church, and so oftentimes we will lead songs in different languages. So today we're going to do a song in French. And so what, first and foremost, if you can and are able, I want to invite you to stand up so that you can join us in worship and song. I want to encourage you today to dance if you can dance. And if you can't dance, make a joyful movement unto the Lord, because he is worthy to Amen. Be praised. Amen? Amen. All right, let's go ahead. Hey. We're going to go to the island of Haiti and declare that he has saved us. He has blessed us. He loves us. He's sanctifying us. He's forgiven us. Of what the Lord has done, and then you will respond in accordance. Amen? Amen. All right. Okay. Yeah. I see some of y'all want to move. Okay. It's all right. You got permission. Amen. you turn to your neighbor and say, he has saved me.
He has saved me.
Turn to your other neighbor and say, he has saved me.
He saved me.
I know that's uncomfortable for a lot of us in the room, but it's a reminder that we're not in this alone. We're in this together. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. We serve an amazing God. Amen. Amen. He is trustworthy, is he not? Yes. He is trustworthy. Whatever he says, you can take it to the bank. He'll do. Amen. If he's promised you anything, he'll do. Just wait for it. Just wait for it. Amen. Amen. Let me catch my breath. We got it. Go. Oh, thank you, Lord. Washed in his blood, and what he did for me on Calvary is more than enough. So I trust in God, my Savior. Every time I cry. we do the bridge again? Can we do it?
I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he seek him out. Did you seek him out? Why?
You know, it's easy to sing these songs and be like, God, I trust you. It's easy to sing, I trust you, God. But you know, sometimes life be life, and amen? And when you get in the thick of it, sometimes it's hard to actually walk that out. Sometimes it's hard to actually put that trust into action. And when God say wait, to actually wait. When God say be still, to actually be still. That's hard work. But thankfully, there's a spirit that's at work within us. Thankfully, there's a spirit that is alive, that has power, the same power that raised Christ up from the dead. That spirit lives in us. And that spirit produces fruit in us, a character in us that enables us to be still when God says to be still. That spirit gives us the character to wait and be patient, to love our neighbor when God says, hey man, you're going too hard on your neighbor, you might need to chill out. Amen. We need that fruit. We need it in us. I need that fruit. I need that juice flowing in me. In me and all up on me. No mistaking when they see me. So they can tell I'm a tree standing in your orchard, standing by living water. You write my story. You the author like DW's brother. I'm saved because you bothered, like brother without the R. I'm after that daily bread. Before Christ, I was a starver. Now the living word fills me all up. And when the world do me dirty, he's the one that I call up. What's big for me, I know to him, that's small stuff. So what's fear? It's false evidence appearing real. Now what's a meal if you ain't eating? A chill pill if you ain't sleeping. When your eyes playing tricks on you, when them shadows start creeping, yo, that's deceiving. Like my God ain't got a power play to melt the idols created face away. New mercies come with every day, and grace still hits in an amazing way. And the sky's still blue under shades of gray. And if the trouble never fades away, he'll still be worthy of every praise. Cause to know him is to love him. And to love him is to know him. Put nobody else above him. God over everything. So never will I sub him. God did on a debut. I'm wide awake. I've never been concerned about a curfew. True story. So even if it gets gory, or he takes me up a few stories, God, you alone get the glory. Never usurping your glory. No metaphors, no allegory. I'll make it plain and make it simple. To God be the glory.
Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise.
Thank you. We thank you for that sweet, amazing grace that you so lavish upon us. God, we thank you that you are a God who has gone before us, behind us, and all around us. And you have had your hand of blessing upon us day in and day out. So, Lord, as the valleys come, as the mountaintops come, would we trust you, Lord? Would we be a people that could love like the way that you have loved us and to have joy that surpasses all understanding, a joy that gives us strength to make it through those valley moments? God, we thank you and we love you. And we give you all of the honor and all the glory forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. It's great to see you all on this beautiful morning. Thank you for those of you watching us online. Good morning to you as well. And if you're a guest, a special welcome to you. Thanks for checking things out. If you don't mind, we'd love to connect with you. There are some QR codes on the seats in front of you. Just scan that. Let us know that you're here. We'd love to be able to help you in the weeks and months to come. Everybody loves a good hack, don't they? Yes. Like three ways to hack your productivity, or, you know, one hack to get your inbox to zero, five hacks to help your toddler when they throw a tantrum, or to potty train your kids, or here's a hack so that you can get your boss to give you a raise, or hacks to get you out of debt, or how to get the best airline price for your upcoming vacation. Does this sound familiar? Yeah. We click on those, don't we? Because hacks are essentially shortcuts, way to simplify the complexities of our life when we have so many things going on. And so we're a sucker for a good shortcut or a hack, even though a lot of times, let's be honest, they don't work, right? Any hack addicts here? Like, I click on those. Today I want to introduce you to a different kind of hack. A shortcut, if you will. Now, last week, if you were here, some of you were watching online. Last week we talked about fruit. Some of you were here. You participated in my distribution of fruit with the little berries and all that. And we discovered that fruitful life, really, is your design, my design. It's our destiny. This is what we were created for, to live a fresh and fruitful life. Jesus was clear about this. We saw this last week. If you weren't here, check it out later. But what does that mean? What does that mean to live a fruitful life, a fresh life? So to answer that, last week we took a look at a list, and we're going to review that again this morning and throughout this whole series. A list that highlights many of the different characteristics and qualities of a fresh life, a fruitful life. So we looked at these last week. I'm going to put them up on the screen here. Here's what we read. This is one particular list that comes out of a passage in the New Testament, found in the book of Galatians, chapter 5, starting at verse 22. For those of you who maybe grew up in church world, you have heard this. Perhaps you memorized this list at some point. But here it is, the fruit of the Spirit. In other words, the kind of qualities of a fresh life, a fruitful life, are things like love, joy, peace, forbearance or patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. So that's one way to summarize a fresh and fruitful life. Last week we said we're going to take a look at each one of those throughout this series. We're going to dig into them and try to discover how do we acquire that kind of fruit. Because most of us would say, yeah, those are good things. Maybe I don't have them, but maybe I'd like them. But 9 is a lot. 9 is a lot. Would you agree? Like, especially for some of us who are trying to look desperately to say, do I even have one of these? So today I want to share with you some good news. There's a hack. There's a shortcut. And here's the shortcut. Love is all you need. I know the song's running through your head. I'll come back to that in a moment. Love is all you need. So first, let's get clear, if we can, for a moment. What do we mean by that? Well, more specifically, what did the writers of Scripture mean by that? We've discussed this a number of times over the years here at Seneca Creek, that when the writers of Scripture talk about love, they're talking about something a little different than we often imagine in our world, in our 21st century Western culture. Love for the writers of Scripture is not primarily a feeling. Now, that doesn't mean there aren't feelings of love, but that is generally not what they're talking about. Love is primarily, for them, and if we're going to understand what they're saying, an action. Love is an action, not a feeling. That doesn't comport, it doesn't line up with the way we have lived our lives in this culture. Because we fall in and out of love, and we talk about love, and it's mushy, and it's Hallmark, and it's Cupid, and it's all these, you know, emotional kind of things. Nothing wrong with emotions. But we have to understand that when our writers of Scripture talk about love, they're primarily talking about love as an action. So I want you to just think for a moment and say in your head, because people don't like it when preachers tell you to turn to the person next to you and say things. So I'm just asking you to say in your head to yourself, if you want to, love is an action. There you go. Love is an action. And that's why you can actually love someone who you can't stand. But Jesus says, love your enemy, right? Like, how can I do that? Because I don't feel very emotional about them. Well, emotional, but it's not love, right? How in the world can you love someone who did you wrong, who stood you up, who made you look bad, who said they would do one thing and then did another? How could you love someone like that? The reality is we do it every day, and it's ourselves. But that's a whole nother sermon. We're not going to go into that today. Why do I say love is all you need? Well, the same guy who wrote that list of nine, a couple verses earlier, made this comment. So I want to take your attention back to Galatians chapter 5, starting in verse 13. You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Again, we talked about this a little bit last week. We're not going to recap all that today. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. See, there's love as an action. You see how that works? And then he goes on, for the entire law, because they'd been arguing about, you know, do we need to obey the law of Moses? The entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command. Here's the hack. You want to simplify the nine and everything else? Paul says, here it is. Love your neighbor as yourself. Full stop. Simple. Not easy. Simple. Right? If you bite and devour each other, watch out or you will be destroyed by each other. What's he talking about? Again, last week we referenced, hey, this was a church. This was a group of followers of Jesus who were literally like at each other's throats. They were arguing. They were fighting. They were dividing. And their disagreements, like they were devouring each other. I mean, it was literally leading to violence. Church people anymore, we don't fight and divide about anything. But back in the day, you know, that happened. Were they acting in the best interest of the other person? Because if love is action, right, it's acting in what is the best interest of the other person. Like if I do what is best for you, that's an act of love. Even if I've got mixed up emotions, right? Even if I don't know you very well, I can still love someone by doing what is in their best interest. So you may recall, Paul, the apostle, was not the first one to talk about love is all you need. Jesus, when he was asked, what's the greatest commandment? What does he say? Love God and love your neighbor. Huh. And then Jesus would later go on to say, hey, this is how people will know that you're following me, that you're lined up with my agenda, with my mission, that you're part of my family, my community, by the love you have for one another. Which is why the Beatles song, All You Need Is Love, like, that's accurate. Now, the rest of the song, it's kind of not so great, right? But that title, that summary, like, that resonates with what Jesus actually said and believed and lived, and what his followers began to preach. But notice that the writer, Paul, not Paul McCartney, Paul the Apostle, he goes on to add another 8 qualities to love. Like, kind of to, let me explain this to you a little bit, all right? Let me break it down in case you're not really sure what all this looks like. And in this series, we're going to go through each one of those other 8. But for now, today, we're just going to look at one more, right? And that is joy. And here's what I'd like to say. Joy rides shotgun. Yeah. Right? Love's driving the car, and Joy's like, I call a shotgun. What does he say? Right? Here's the fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy. Again, we can think about joy as a fleeting emotion, and we have fleeting emotions of joy from time to time, but that's not what he's talking about. And ultimately, that's not a fruitful life. That's kind of just, it's here and it's there and it's everywhere and it's gone, right? The writers of Scripture had a different idea about joy. I'm going to put a definition up here on my little device. And I stole this from a guy named Dallas Willard. But many others have spoken the same kinds of concepts. Joy is a pervasive, this is from the standpoint of the writers of Scripture, right? This is when they're like, what does joy actually look like? And by the way, joy shows up hundreds and hundreds of times in the writings of the writers of Scripture. Joy, a pervasive, constant, and unending sense of well-being that flows from vision, peace, and hope. It is robust, being experienced even in the midst of suffering and loss. Which is why we say it's not an emotion, because in times of suffering and loss, like, we don't feel very, like, everything's bad, it's dark, it's gloomy, it's whatever. But there can still be this pervasive, constant, and unending sense of well-being. Where does that come from? Well, remember, Paul is saying, this is the fruit of the Spirit of God. This is God at work. Consider one of the hundreds of uses of joy that we find in the pages of Scripture. The writer of Psalm 126 says this in Psalm 126:3, "The Lord has done great things for us, and we are filled with joy." In other words, God is at work. We sang about this earlier, right? 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus. Like, and just reflecting on that for many of us brings us to this point of saying, yeah, there is a constant, pervasive sense of well-being because of what God has done and is doing. In another song, these are not up on the screen, right? The psalmist says, "Satisfy us in the morning with your unfailing love that we may sing for joy and be glad all our days." In other words, he's connecting God's love and the joy that flows out of that. Joy rides shotgun. Another, maybe a little bit more familiar passage for some of us is found in the Gospel of Luke, where the angel says, "Hey, you know what, shepherds? Something really cool is about to happen." In Luke chapter 2, starting in verse 10, the angel says, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people." Huh. How do you like that? See, in the ancient world, emotions were generally considered in the Greco-Roman world as these irrational impulses that were supposed to be controlled by a rational person. Now, we can pull that apart and find some things we like and don't like about that. But joy and happiness referred to this complex of tendencies and behaviors that were associated with human flourishing. In other words, fruitfulness. So, when God's love shows up and begins to kind of leak out of our lives, joy is riding shotgun. Which, of course, causes us to just do a little analysis on what's going on, which brings me to my next point. Check your produce bin. If we're using this analogy, now I remember my mom, who grew up on one of 11 kids on a farm in Minnesota, and they didn't have electricity for most of it. They had a root cellar. Most of us don't know what that is. But that's where you would put the vegetables that you harvest during the year, and you stick them down there because they stay cool, and then you can eat them all winter long. But in the root cellar, apparently in the house, occasionally one of the potatoes would go bad. You ever smell a bad potato? Yeah. So when you got a whole cellar full of potatoes, and if you don't get the bad ones out, guess what? Everything else rots with it. So my mom, as one of the older kids, would have the unenviable job of going down into the dark root cellar and finding the rotten potato. And you do that by like reaching in until you find the squishy mess. You know what I'm talking about? That's nasty. This happened, like, we don't have root cellars, we have refrigerators. And they have vegetable and produce drawers. And guess what happens in the back of those? Mm-hmm. You clean out the fridge, you're like, I don't know what this is. I don't know what it used to be. Nobody's going to eat it. And it smells bad. Am I talking to anybody? Have you been there? Are we the only ones that do that in our house? All right. Check your produce bin. Right? If a fresh, fruitful life is your destiny, then it makes sense every now and then to just do a check and say, what is actually living in here? Is it love? Is it joy? You know, the best person to check your produce bin is you. I mean, you might have some, you know, unrequested help from family members, but honestly, we are the best ones at doing an evaluation and saying, is my life bearing the fruit of love, of acting in the best interest of others, of joy, of this pervasive, unending sense of well-being? Is that fruit actually in my life, in my produce bin? Sometimes when we check, we find that there might be fruit there, but it's not very good. So I'm going to take you back to Paul's comments back in the book of Galatians, starting in chapter 5, verse 19. And he says, you know what? There's some other kinds of fruit you might find. The acts of the flesh, he says, are obvious. Sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. What is he saying? That's not the flourishing life. That's not the fruitful life. That's not the destiny. That's not what Jesus came and invited you to be a part of. But he says the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. They've cleaned out the produce bin. The idea here, right, is to compare the two different sets of qualities. So when you look in your life, what do you see? What do you see? Do you see love? Do you see joy? And why not? Why not? So last week, we realized that there are two essential ingredients for this fresh life. Hesitate to ask if anyone remembers what they were. That was 7 days ago. Any brave people? Crucifixion of the flesh. Very good. All right, there'll be a little something extra in your check at the end of the month. And the other one was partnering with the Spirit, right, with the Spirit's guidance and power. And so I want to come back to that today because this is so important for us and so easy to miss. And that is that we need to partner with the Spirit in order to live this kind of life. Like, even if love is all you need, like, if that's the hack, okay, but we're still going to need some help, right? Maybe you're like one of the, I've talked to so many people over the years, like, Pastor Mark, like, I see that, like, I just don't have it in me to love this person. Am I talking to anybody here? Yes, I know. I've talked with some of you. You've said those words to me. I couldn't agree with you more. Like, we don't have it in us to love these kinds of people. I love what one New Testament scholar said, being able to love others is not the result of discipline. It is a miracle. Let me say that again, right? Being able to love the other person is not a matter of discipline. It's a miracle. What am I talking about? Miracles are divine intervention into the natural order of things. Miracles are divine interventions into the natural order of things, including my life and your life. And God's Spirit is the ever-present power that we can tap into in order to live that kind of miracle. The Spirit is the one who empowers us to live not the way we were, but the way we were designed. Right? The Spirit is the power we can tap into to live not the way we were, but the way we were designed. It's not just a matter of discipline. It takes power outside of us. On our best day, yeah, we can love some people who are not very unlovable. But day after day, hour after hour, moment after moment, the people who are most frustrating and annoying, who often occupy the same home or the same office or the same classroom, like, we just don't have that capacity in and of ourselves. But Jesus says, that's okay. I'm giving you the Holy Spirit. It's called being transformed. Paul talks about this in another letter that he writes in 2 Corinthians chapter 3 in verse 17. Now the Lord is the Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There's that theme coming back again. And we all who with unveiled faces contemplate the Lord's glory. In other words, we're focused on Jesus and his call and what he is doing in our world and in our lives. We who with unveiled faces contemplate the Lord's glory are being transformed into his image with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. You say, hey, this change, this ability to bear fruit and to love others who, like, in and of ourselves, we'd be like, I just don't think I have it in me. Jesus says, that's okay. I'm going to put it in you. I'm going to help you. There's going to be transformation. Have you experienced that? Is that how your life looks? Because that's what's on offer from Jesus. So what does it look like? Like, how do you partner with someone you can't see or touch or feel? So again, Paul gives us some, I think, helpful guidelines, some steps. We might even call them hacks if you want, to how do we actually partner with the Spirit. So let me take you back to Galatians chapter 5, again, starting in verse 16. And here's what Paul says. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. Right? So that whole flesh is like, this is me going my way as opposed to God's way. Right? Walk by the Spirit. For the flesh desires what's contrary to the Spirit. The Spirit's what's contrary to the flesh. They're in conflict with each other. We talked about this a little bit more last week. So that you are not to do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, so first he says walk by the Spirit, then led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. And then a couple verses later, since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit and not become conceited, provoking, and envying each other. So he breaks this down, and I want to just spend a moment here talking about these three different ideas that he's discussing here of how do we actually partner with the Spirit of God. So he mentions walk by the Spirit, be led by the Spirit, and keep in step with the Spirit. What does that mean? Let me give you my best understanding of this. Walking by the Spirit is what I will call, an orientation or a posture, right? To walk by the Spirit is to orient my life along the lines of the Spirit's guidance. And to say, you know what? This is my general posture in life. My posture is that I'm desiring God's guidance and His Spirit in my daily life. Like that, that presumes something, and maybe that is or is not your current orientation toward life. But Paul is saying, hey, if you want to partner with the Spirit, if you want to experience this fruitful life, then try orienting your life. Walk by the Spirit. So what does he mean by be led by the Spirit? And I would say this is basically attentiveness. If you're new to Seneca Creek and you're wondering, how is his handwriting so bad? I've been working on it for 60 years. If you ever tried to lead someone who's not paying attention, maybe a child or whatever, right? Guess what happens? Like, they're not following you. There's no, like, if you get distracted and you're supposed to be following someone, guess what happens? You're not following them anymore. It requires an attentiveness to say, oh, hey, I should like pay attention. I should check in. I should keep my eye on what's going on over here. Attentiveness to the Spirit is a daily, hourly, maybe even moment by moment kind of decision. And the question to ask each of ourselves is that how I live my life? Like partnering with the Spirit and experiencing the fruitfulness. By the way, I just realized this happened. I'm sorry. So this fruit here is plastic. This fruit is not. I like throwing things out. Are there any good catch people here? Oh, there we go. All right. I have apple. Oh, we got one there. Oh, look at that. Oh, banana. Anybody? A banana right there. Okay. I got lots of oranges. Oh, I don't want to leave you folks out over here. Oh, there we go. Another one. Okay. Any more? Way in the back. Oh, all right. Here we go. Check it out. Right. Good catch. Over here. Anybody? All right. Oh, it wasn't bruised when it left my hand. Anybody over here? Anybody? Kyle, come on, you got it, man. All right, thank you. One more orange. Oh, that apple's got something wrong with it. We got any more back here? Way in the back. All right, here it comes. Woo! Okay, we got some real athletes. We should start like a softball team or something. Anyway, yeah. Fruit, right? That made more sense if I had thrown the fruit out when I was supposed to. Anyway. No, I've just dragged. The low-hanging lights. Yeah, that was too bright. I've completely lost my train of thought. Sorry about that. Where was I? Okay, attentiveness. Yeah, speaking of attentiveness. Okay, what does it mean? Nikki's sneaking up here. I must be almost done. Sorry. Don't play that Beatles song, whatever you do. Keep in step with the Spirit. What does that mean? What does that mean to keep in step with the Spirit? Well, here, again, this is my best understanding, is that this is ongoing effort. Ongoing effort. Like it isn't magic. I have to bring myself into this. What is the Spirit saying to me? Am I willing to put in the effort to listen? What is the Spirit saying to me in this moment, in this conversation, in this space, in this conflict, in this opportunity? In this temptation, am I willing to pause for a moment and kind of turn my attention and say, Spirit of God, what do you want me to hear or to do in this space? For many of us, walking in step with the Spirit will require a change in our routine, in our habits. Because it's so easy for us to get into the routines that we have of doing the things that are right in front of us and the expectations of others and all the scripts that have been programmed into us by ourselves and by our culture and by our family and by our pain and our woundedness. And those things just, those scripts go all the time and they're never stopping. And yet if we want to walk in step with the Spirit, if we want to keep in step with the Spirit, we're going to have to stop and say, wait a minute. What is the Spirit of God saying in this moment? Maybe it means before I roll out of bed in the morning and check whatever else is going on that I just pause and say, God, what do you have for me in this moment? Before I step into a classroom as a student or as a teacher, as I'm walking across that threshold to just pause and ask, God, do you have something for me in this space? If the Spirit of God is truly working in our world and in our lives, then maybe we need a routine and a change of habit that encourages us to stop and pause and listen. Maybe it's as simple as putting something on the bathroom mirror so that when you're looking at yourself and you're thinking about what you don't like about yourself and all these things, you can just see that reminder to say, walk in step with the Spirit in this moment. I added this little thing to the bottom of my phone because I don't know about you, but I spent a lot of time looking at my phone. And so I put this little saying at the bottom. It says, walk in step with the Spirit. And I hope that that will encourage me as well throughout the day to say, what is God wanting to do right now? Before you turn the key to start your car and drive off to wherever you're going, before you react to that insult or that feedback or that social media post, before you walk into that meeting with your boss or your employee, maybe it just means that we craft a routine that will cultivate that partnership that will create the fruit we were designed for. I came across a story of a guy whose life really exemplifies this. His name's Wayne Gordon. Wayne Gordon grew up in a Christian home in the Midwest and, you know, went to Sunday school and all this stuff. But he went on a camp retreat and God really spoke to him. And he's, you know, in a moment of prayer, he said, God, I want to do whatever you want. It was that openness and that posture toward the Spirit of God. And he seemed to hear these words, God saying to him, I want you to be with African Americans. This is a guy who grew up in a lily white neighborhood. And he thought, Africa? And God's like, no, here. So he went downstairs. He told his parents, he said, I'm supposed to go to the inner city. They said, well, maybe you should finish high school and college. So he did. And then he worked in the inner city, got involved in an African-American community of Chicago. He was a football coach, got a teaching job. He was the only teacher in the entire system who lived in the immediate area. He started to form groups for Bible study. He began to talk to the kids that he was coaching about faith and Jesus. Some of them became followers of Christ. He walked with them through their various struggles. One thing led to another. They started a tutoring program and then a medical program. Today, he runs a multi-million dollar program with 21 full-time doctors in a clinic. They've renovated millions of dollars of low-income housing. They start small businesses to provide economic base in the inner city. He's been joined by other African-American leaders to help pastor the church that to this day continues to thrive. He helped found the CCDA, the Christian Community Development Association, a network of organizations that are working together under the cause of Christ to make a difference in our country and around the world. I just unplugged that, but I don't need it anymore. His name was Wayne Gordon, and don't miss the point. Like, his story is not my story or your story, but what he did was he said, I want to posture my life in a way that I can hear what God has for me. And when he began to do that, his life began to bear fruit. Fruit that will last. Fruit that basically Jesus says, this is how they'll know you're my followers. The same spirit that he partnered with is the same spirit you and I can partner with. Right? The shortcut to the fruitful life is love and joy riding shotgun. Okay? But that kind of miraculous fruit is going to take partnership with the Spirit of God. It's going to require that we orient our lives toward walking with the Spirit, that we have the attentiveness of living by the Spirit and being led by the Spirit, and then that we have this ongoing effort of saying, yeah, I want to walk in step with God's Spirit. My hope and prayer for you is that that is how you live the rest of your life, that every day and every moment you realize God is speaking and working and interacting with me and producing the fruit I could never do by myself. That's your destiny and your design. That's the offer that Jesus has. My prayer and hope is that you will take him up on that and begin to live that this day. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for each person here, for those in the room, for those online. God, for those who have been struggling with doubt and fear and uncertainty and a produce bin that doesn't look very good, God, would you make today the day that they can begin to partner with your Spirit, to take up Jesus' invitation and offer, to follow in his footsteps, to be transformed into his character, and to begin to bear fruit, things like love and joy that leak out of us into a world that is desperately looking for the real thing. God, give us the perseverance and the grace and the patience to allow you to work in our lives. Help us to ask the hard questions, to be honest with ourselves, and then to take those next steps each and every day to live a fresh and fruitful life. We pray this and ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, thank you all for joining. Thank you for those of you watching online. Before you go, some opportunities that are just around the corner here at Seneca Creek, and Heather is here to tell us about them. Did you want any fruit?
I'm good.
Okay.
You tried to give me some when we were practicing, and I was dodging them.
You did good.
Yeah, I did.
You did well.
I was not about to try and catch them, because if you know me, that's not going to work. Anyway, so opportunities. I actually am excited because a lot of our opportunities, we have three that we're going to talk about this morning, intersect with this idea of story. If you're like me, sometimes parties or gatherings can be a little awkward. Like, it's not a problem meeting new people. Like, that's fine. That's nice. But you don't feel connected to them, right? Until you sit down and you get to hear a little more about their story. Like, what is your story? That's one of my favorite questions to ask, and I actually don't mind if people ask me that because I'm pretty transparent that way. And so we want to invite you, if you're relatively new to Seneca Creek, or maybe you're coming back after some time away, or maybe you're just really curious and you need to know a little bit more about us, we want to invite you to discover Seneca Creek. Come and find out more about our story, how we came to be, why we're in this building, how we got here, because let me tell you, it was a journey. we want to invite you. It starts in May, late May. There are just three meetings online for an hour. You get an opportunity to meet some of the staff and hear some of the stories. But then at the end of that, we're going to gather for lunch with all of the staff that's available and enjoy lunch together. And again, exchange story. Hear a little bit more about who we are and why we do things the way we do things and all that kind of fun stuff. So I want to invite you to that. It's actually really, really fun, and we get some really awesome questions, and so it's great. So I want to invite you to that. The next thing is for our students. If you have a seventh grader or an eighth grader, or you are one, you do not want to miss the upcoming spring retreat. This is an opportunity for students to get connected in healthy relationships and make some incredible lifelong memories. Actually, similar to what you were talking about in the story of Mr. Gordon. Mm-hmm. Right? So these kinds of camps or retreats are just incredibly powerful environments where students get to know leaders, they get connected with adults who care about them, who pour their lives into them, and then they also get connected to each other. I think when our kids get to middle school, it's hard to know who they're connected to. And this is a great way to make sure they make some really healthy, good connections. So check that out. You can scan the code. It's also on the app and on our website. Everything that I'm going to talk about is there as well. And then last but not least, we have an upcoming baptism celebration. And if you have never experienced baptism or seen baptism here at Seneca Creek, let me tell you, it is a party. But this is also one of the most powerful ways to hear stories, mm-hmm. to hear stories of how God is working in unbelievable transformative ways in people's lives, ways that you see the Spirit just laid out absolutely blatantly that you cannot deny. It is so powerful. And maybe you're sitting there like, yeah, I've got a story, and I don't know what baptism is. Like, I was raised in a tradition that didn't do baptism the way we do baptism here. Like, we did infant baptism. So what is baptism at Seneca Creek? If you have questions like that, or what does it mean? What does it look like? How do I do that? Where does this happen? You want to check out our baptism information, which is online as well, and then get connected, and we will walk you through that process so that you can make that decision as to whether baptism is the next step for you. We invite everyone to participate. It's absolutely fantastic. And that's what I got. Those are the three.
Those are great opportunities.
Yeah, they are.
Take advantage of those. Also, a word of thanks to everyone here in the room and online who gives to Seneca Creek, to the ministry here. What we are able to do throughout the week, throughout the year, could not happen without your generosity. So please accept our heartfelt gratitude and thanks. If you haven't started a generosity journey and this is your church home, let me encourage you. It's a great way to get started. Today's a great day to do that. There's several ways up there on the screen. If you're watching online, we'd love to have you be a part of that as well. And then if you need someone to pray with you today, maybe you came in here carrying a burden or a concern or something else, our prayer team is here and available. Just make your way to the back corner by the exit sign. They'll meet with you and pray with you right after we're finished. If you're watching online, just text the word prayer to 301-900-2920. Having said that, let me ask you if you would stand with us. I'd like to pray for you before we're done here. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the work that you have done in our world, in our lives. God, we have talked and sung about your faithfulness and your trustworthiness. God, as we go out of here now, would you continue your work? Would you open our hearts and our minds and our ears to your guidance and your power and your will for each one of us, God, that we could live that out fully and begin to experience the kind of fruitful and fresh life that Jesus calls us to. We pray and ask all this in his name, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you all for coming. Have a great week.
Hey everyone, thanks so much for joining our Sunday gathering. Whether you watched live or at another time, our hope and prayer is that you were inspired and encouraged by the music and message. There are loads of other ways to get connected at Seneca Creek Community Church, and we want to invite you to jump in and check them out. First, if you're new or new-ish, text WELCOME to 301-900-2920 so we can connect. We won't spam you, we promise. It's just an invitation for you to get to know us better, to peek behind the scenes and ask us questions freely. Secondly, if you're interested in more community opportunities, check out the link in the description below for events, signups, and for opportunities to serve and love our neighbors and so much more. And if you're really interested in keeping up to date on all the activities here at Seneca Creek, download our app for quick and easy access. Lastly, we want you to make sure you press that thumbs up, like this video, subscribe to our channel, and check out our other social media platforms. Those links are also in the description below. We hope to see you soon, whether online or in person.